following interview was conducted with Virgil Anderson for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Thursday, the 10th of January, 2006, at his residence in West Lafayette. The interviewer is Katherine Markee, the Oral History Librarian. Welcome.
Tell us. This is 2008.
2008, right. I stand corrected. Tell us where you were born and your parents in the early years.
I was born in North Liberty, Indiana. That's about 15 miles south Bend. And on a farm. And we had two farms. One was my dad's farm and one was my grandfather's farm. And we used horses continuously on the farm. So I was there until I graduated from high school. And learned to milk when I was 5 years old. And so worked all the way through. It was good training, but I knew that I didn't want to stay. World War II was coming on, and Dad asked if I would stay on the farm. I didn't know. I said, I'll take my chances in the Army. So I left. I started going to school at Iowa State College at Ames. And that was in 1940. And then World War II came along, and I was in the Army for 4 years. And only in Army occupation in Japan for a year in 1945. We were the first troops to enter Yokohama and went up to Hokkaido at a little town of Hasegawa. And that was quite an experience.
How was that? Can you make a comment on that?
I really enjoyed it. There was a school we built.
Had there been devastation there?
Yokohama was absolutely, and Tokyo absolutely obliterated. All you saw when we went through on the train to catch the boat to go to north to Hokkaido was just smokestacks. Everything was knocked out. It was terrible. Look at the mess. We got on a boat and went across the channel up to Hokkaido. And it sort of steep, and it was at an angle when it went over. We didn't know we could make it. But anyway, we got in the shore, and we had hardly any food, so I rode back quick for my wife. We were married at that time. And I said, send us some food. But by the time the food came, we'd already got real good rations by then. But one thing was very, very interesting. When we marched into Asaigawa, every shade in that town, I still remember, were pulled down, and we went to our quarters. I was a second lieutenant, so I was in the barracks behind where the officer stayed. And we had a houseboy kept the shiner shoes and did their stuff for us. Anyway, I said, I guess I could speak Japanese well enough to talk with him. And I said, why were all those shades pulled down? He said, we were told that they would kill all the men and rape all the women when we came into town. So that was the whole deal. And this kid was 13 years old, was a kamikaze pilot, and he had already had his funeral. He said that he got into the plane that morning and they had dropped the wheels on the plane because that's when they took off. Well, that was the way they would drop them off after they went into flight. But anyway, he was saying, all at once the mission was stopped, scrubbed. I said, how did you feel? He says, I felt good. I was no kidding about that. But he was a 13-year-old kid. So that was really quite an experience. We had I was in charge. We were down to Sendai, and they got an army school set up for the soldiers coming in. would take courses. Well, I'd been here at Purdue Iowa State until the junior year. So I'd had enough math as a major in math. And so they let us teach certain type courses. So I taught some analytic geometry, basic calculus, and stuff like that in the school. But I had, one of the things we had to do was to train the people to build this place, to get the school built. So I had a little carpenter, just a short little guy, just eager as heck, just a great guy. And we got so we could talk all right. And so we built shelves and all this stuff. And then when I got word after I was over there about a year, we were getting pretty close. We had cigarettes or some chocolate. I'd always see that he got in his chair. Anyway, he came out with a little geeky girl in silk, just gorgeous thing, when I was leaving. And I said, "You didn't need to do this." He said that it was kind of fun, nice. But he says, "I've enjoyed it so much." And he started having tears in his eyes. I had really touched me.
Did he speak English?
Oh, yeah, no. Yeah, we spoke enough.
What, when you taught the class, were you teaching it in English?
Oh, yes, everything. Well, all the teaching was done for the armed forces.
Oh, not for the community.
We didn't teach for any Japanese.
Okay.
But I didn't have any trouble going downtown to speak to when I wanted to get anything from the store.
Sure.
But that was the most touching thing I had over there.
And then after, when you helped, you were there a year, and then did you come back? What
yes,
happened next?
Yes, I came back here and then went back to school.
You finished there?
Finished at Iowa State and went on, tried different places and felt that I might as well go on for a PhD. They got a PhD there too. But I'd never done it without that GI Bill because I didn't have any money.
Sure.
We had three kids by then.
Where'd you meet your wife?
In high school.
Okay. Your high school sweetheart, huh?
You're right.
That's nice.
64 years.
Wonderful. That's marvelous.
That's really a nice life.
Where are the children today?
One of the boys here, he's has retired from State Farm, and have one daughter in Manassas, Washington, D.C. She's a nurse who's in a headache clinic and handles all these drug jobs and come in and sets up experiments for these people to run them, and then she conducts those experiments. I have another daughter who's out of Scottsdale, Arizona, and her husband is a civil engineer, and I'd had him in class. And anyway, the group's good.
Nice. Then after you got your PhD, does that bring you to Purdue? What was
yes.
your call? Oh, it came straight after there.
Came directly to here.
Yes. How did that, did you, were they advertising or how did you have
oh, them? Yeah, they were trying to get the Department of the Statistics Laboratory, which was called then, started. And a guy by the name of Kosick was in charge of it. And Carl then hired me. I had not finished the PhD yet. I'd finished the prelims and was writing the thesis, and I ran out of GI money. I used all 48 months of it up, but I'd run out of money, and so they let me come here, and this Dean Ayers, I don't know if you've ever heard of him.
I recognize the name.
Okay, Dean Ayers was the Dean of Science at that time. I still remember. He took us out to breakfast, and that was the way it went. And so I ordered the eggs and a bunch of stuff. So he said, "Well," he said, "I want to tell you something." He says, "You did the right thing." He says, "You tasted your eggs before you salted them." And he says, if I had seen anybody that salted them before they tasted their eggs, I wouldn't have hired them. But isn't it dumb? The things I've heard is just...
You ought to write those all down, right? Yeah. Well, then you were head of... Tell us a little bit about your involvement with Purdue. You were head of the statistical lab?
Yes. And then, trying to get the date about right. I think it was about 58, something like that.
Uh-huh.
Carl Crossing then decided to join IBM. And then they decided that he should be, rather than take that job, should be the head of the math department. Well, since he was the head of the whole math department, which included statistics group at that time, we weren't a department, he asked me if I would direct the stat and computing lab. And I said, yeah, I'd be fine. So for 10 years, I was a director of that lab, and that's when they had the great big computers and
big ones. Physically.
Yes. With a bunch of cards and all these things. So that was quite a time.
Yeah. And were there, you did some military flared statistical design for Crane Ammunition in 66, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. You know, that's really, I've forgotten about that. Bob McLean was a student in statistics, and he'd been in a class with me. And I always thought that guy is good. I'm not like him to go on for PhD. I argued with him and everything. He said, no, I'm not finished. I said, okay, Bob, in 5 years, you'll be calling me and asking to come back and work on a PhD. He said, oh, baloney. I think it is almost to the day. He called me at night. Virgil, I can't fit. I gotta come back. I said, okay. So he came back. And so we were working on a project after he had come back for Crane Ammunition Depot. And it had to do with these flares that shoot out so that they could see what was going on in the ocean, and they were having a 33% failure rate. So Bob and I worked on this, and suddenly one night I came up with a design that I thought of an experiment that should work with it. We had something like 17 variables in that thing. So we cut her back, and the combination I still remember, having all the kids around, I'd give them certain jobs because they made it sure that we didn't confound anything within this. And Bob was helping me set this up. So we presented this, and oh boy, it went over great. And that rate dropped to about a 1%. And God, they thought that, you know, we were magic. Jeez, it was awful. I just felt so bad because they gave us credit for doing this sort of thing, that the engineers, you know, actually performed all the experiments and everything. And it was sort of embarrassing that it came out this way, that the newspapers had this. And I don't think Crane ever really felt very good to us at all. But anyway, we solved the problem.
Solved the problem, right, yeah. How about your interaction with students? You had a lot of contact with the students.
Oh.
Now, then you stayed in the math department and all this time, mm-hmm. statistics, okay? And
yeah.
Now, of course, it's separate. There's separate units, statistics.
Yeah. In 69, Dean Haas was our Dean of Science. No, he's provost then. Came in and asked me if I would like to head up the Department of Statistics. I told him, I said, Dean Haas, I said, I don't have the mathematics experiments experience. I said, I'm a statistician who believes in setting up experiments. I see them, and I can visualize what to do, but I don't know enough mathematics. I said, we've got to get somebody else. He said, okay. He says, you had a chance. I said, okay, but I'm not going to do it. So Gupta took it.
Okay. I recognize the name, sure. Uh-huh. We also had a Center for Statistical Decision Sciences that opened in 87, didn't it?
Yes. That was just when I left.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
Right.
And what was Berger?
That could have been.
I think it was Berger who was really, he was the hot shot in this area that, say that would be from 69 to 87, so that was almost 20 years there. That Gupta was in charge.
Sure.
And he built up one really good faculty. That move to have him department head was right.
Yeah.
It wasn't wrong. I just went back to be a consultant, teach, and that's all. That's all I was good for.
Was the statistical lab still running at that time?
Oh, yes.
Oh, okay. Oh, so yeah. You still had that, too?
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
The lab is still there.
Sure. Okay. All right. Now, you also served under a couple presidents, Huffy and Baring, right? Any comment? They're a little bit different.
I tell you, Huffy.
He was the president when you came.
He was just excellent. Just an assistant professor. In fact, I had a problem. I could call him up and go and see him. It was just a dang nice arrangement. Now, let's see, who was the...
After him was...
No, I'm not president. The vice president of the... In charge of... finances.
Chana? Or Harvey Stewart?
Harvey Stewart. Harvey Stewart. People didn't think much of him. I think he is the one that really made Purdue University. In my mind, he saw that all of his land was gotten and everything.
People have recounted that.
And everybody always made such nasty remarks about him. I said, well, you just don't know it. And,
you can't see the big picture.
Yes, and this is the reason I feel so close. There was a student in the statistics department who was just very, very sick. And she was in the hospital, and I didn't oversee her. And she says, Dr. Anderson, I'd just like to die. I went through hell. I said, well, I just don't have enough money to pay for this. She didn't have enough money to pay for any of this stuff. I thought and thought and thought about the problem. Finally, I said, I'm going over and see how he's doing. Called him up, went over to see him. Told him the story. He says, hell, Anderson, you don't want a loan. He says, you need money right now. He said, I'll see that you get it.
Very nice. Nicely done. Top of the line.
Very nice. Yeah, I'm sorry, but I never could see him. I don't think he ever listened to the faculty's comments at all. The claim of the thing really bothered me. I shouldn't say this, I suppose, but number one, my whole family is based on German, so I'm a lot of German in me. But he was an MD who was a German. And I said, anybody that's had those two characteristics made a president that you can't talk to, and he certainly turned out that way. Just a guy that I don't know of any faculty member that I knew that liked him at all. Everybody loved him.
How about campus life during the 50s and 60s? What was it like?
You know, they had, I can say dirty word, they talked about on how they, it was in the student paper that's gone. It just made me so mad with these guys. There was one football player who just always forget his name, but he's a great big defensive man. And he came in the union one time and told this guy, this is the university, and actually it's street right
in the union?
Union building. Lie around and everything. Get along here, boy, they scrambled out of there. And but it was terrible. The attitude and all was. But the thing is that I, at that time, I was teaching only graduate students. And they were pretty good. There was one little, I never forget it, a little girl from the psychology department. She sat about the third or fourth row, but there was no student in the next chair up there. Well, I remember the details, I don't know.
It's good, yeah. It adds to it.
She sat there and put her feet up there, and the back of her feet were absolutely just dirt, just caked with dirt. I mean, just cuter than a button, but it's just typical.
This is her feet, not the shoes.
Feet.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah, no shoes. None of them had shoes on. But I just said, if I looked at that, I just had to laugh. It was just so funny. But she was a sharp kid, and I really liked her. That was sort of the experience.
Did the did the enrollment increase in statistics over time?
Oh, yeah, my God.
And also on the graduate level, too, at the graduate level?
Yeah. Now it's absolutely phenomenal how many people they have over there. But I remember one year I was teaching an undergraduate class, and I always prided myself on being able to remember everybody. I told them to sit in the same seats all the time because I want to know your name. And I said, if I see you there every time, I know your name. So they don't go on to that. I got this one class of 72 students in the great big room. God, I hated it. I couldn't, there's no way that I could handle it. But students made it just wonderful. We had, I'd say about 3 or 4 weeks ago, I got a letter through the from a former student who's been in genetics. Now my thesis was on a genetics statistics problem. I wrote a PhD thesis in that area, so genetics is my next field. And so all of the students in genetics would always come over. I'd have them in class. Well, all of the professors that I worked with, Bell and Born, everybody except Truman Martin, now he's still over here. He was younger than the rest of them. I imagine he's probably in his early 70s, but I'm mid-80s, but he was the only one left of that whole crew who was teaching those people. I got this letter, and they said they were going to have a genetics meeting of the old genetics students from a certain time, rural Bell's time, to whatever, and asked if I'd come. I said, boy, I wouldn't miss it.
Where was it held?
And it was held over here at the Union Building. And they had, well, I would like to have gone to the game and all that, but I couldn't do it. I said, I'll go to the dinner afterwards, be definitely there. That's when the big affair of me and them talked. I got there. Yeah, must have been between 20 and 30 of those former students, and I knew everything.
Wonderful.
And they got up. So dumb things happen in those classes. I just about died. It was just so damn fun.
It's even more appreciated today. I would talk, you had mentioned earlier off the tape, but you, after you retired, and you said you had to retire, it was a mandatory retirement at that time, and then what transposed, you went to Texas?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right away. Yeah.
Right. And were there for 10 years in teaching, is that right?
Then I retired from there, and then we went into near Georgetown, a little southwestern Texas school was there. And that was nice. I met some people.
Was this another school you were teaching then?
Well, no, I didn't do any more teaching. I was retired. I played a lot of golf. Uh-huh. There's a group there. We play it, oh, two or three times a week all the time. When I was still in the 70s, early 80s, everything was great. And there was one guy, I don't know, this guy's name was Monroe. And he loved these oddball things that they'd have over at the university. And that was the kind of guy I was, too. I didn't know any other people like that. And so we'd go to these things, and he'd have something outdoors with a telescope so you could even see Saturn and all this stuff. It was great, a lot of fun.
Oh, it sounds good.
And then I got sick and I had to leave. And then he got both his wife died after we had here. While we were there, it was real
right.
fun.
Yeah. When you're looking, you talked about Erskine Morse. Any other faculty that you interacted with pretty much when you were here?
Oh, yeah. George McCabe probably was the...
Was he in your department?
Uh-huh. We had a project. I'd forgotten about it. Herman Rubin, you don't know him probably, but Herman was a genius. He got his PhD at 19 or 18, something like that. Okay, and so they hired him. Guthrie was hot to get him here. He's still teaching, as I mentioned before. And he's just a little bit, a couple of years younger than I, so he got under the wire and he could stay. He was given the project. There was a $21 million job. That was $15 million. Had to do with NIH providing funds for different projects on campus. NIH was on their backs because the women at the university here were saying they weren't getting paid for the same amount of work. So the company came in to me and said, Herman's been working on this problem for 2 years or more. He says, he just doesn't get anything done. He says, I'm giving this to you. I said, I'll take it. But I said, no, I'll take it under these circumstances. He is not to be even considered to be at this place. I don't want him at all. But I would like to have certain people. Cave was one. And Betty Sudar would be one. Betty Payne would be one. And I had one other man that I can't remember, but McCabe was a big one. And Sudar was and Payne were just wonderful. I mean, they really think good. I knew Betty Sudar did.
Sure. Uh-huh.
And so I'd known her all this time. She used to work over with Cossack and Leia when I first came here. And so we started working on this thing, and I said, well, one thing we have to do, we have to have at least one of both sexes represented in every department that we're going to interview. Every one of them has to have some match, minimum of one person in that class, in that group, has to be of the other sex. Because you can't compare home economics with engineering. I said, you just can't do it. So I said, yeah, that's the only way we're going to go. I called John Hicks, and I said, well, the only thing we can do is to go up to Chicago and see this NIH fella and talk it over with John. Yeah, it's not going to work. I know John Paul is my full name. Because I work with him on meat studies over there a lot of time. Anyway, John, I said, well, this is it, John. I said, if you don't let me go up there, I'm quitting. He said, okay, I'll have a plane tomorrow. You got a plane for us? We went up there.
In the Purdue plane.
And talked to this guy. And at first he said, I'll give you 15 minutes. I said, okay. I said, here's the deal. And I laid it out to him. Oh, the only way you're going to get anything to compare is that you have to have both represented. Well, I didn't think of that. He says, he told his girl, he says, take your morning off or we're going to go into this in detail. So we worked on a plan, and George did a terrific job, too. And that was a fundamental thought. Then we had to do a comprise and make it up so that you could get the respondents from all of the people. Oh, I was, everything I do, somebody always gets angry at me. Anyway, just, I worked with the home economist people. Eve Grobo, in fact, is over here now. Eve and I had a lot of experience with each other on the problem with the, that were in the home ec department. And other people had a lot of help and different other problems. So I worked with them on a lot of theses, really. And they were happy. And one of them even invited, he was my wife and I out to dinner, and we went over there, and there's a chummy outfit. But when we got the results of this whole thing, some departments that had, especially in the math department, that the men were actually underpaid relative to some of the senior women. And so this just cooked. I mean, it just was, well, it sold the deal. I mean, there's no problem with getting the money then. But the home economy people, home economics people, they didn't want to have anything to do with me after that. So I've
had a lot of these things are going to turn out, you know.
A lot of experience.
I would say so, yeah. All right. Got a favorite outstanding event in your life that comes to mind?
I think the most pleasant thing that ever happened to me was that meeting with these genetics people where all these students got up one by one and talked stuff that I had done with them, what they had done, cut. They were really sharp people. I mean, they had gone into business, and all of them were just so successful. Of course, every darn one of them was a PhD kind of person, so they're just top notch. But just the comments. I'll show you one thing.
Wait, okay. When you finish this year. Then you reflect back on your time at Purdue, the statistics, how it grew, and you're glad you came.
Oh, my gosh, the best thing ever happened to me. You know, the thing that was so impressive was the first week that I was here. He was the assistant dean of agriculture. I was working the third time in ag, third in engineering, third in statistics, and teaching here and then consulting with him. But he called me in his office. I can't remember his name right now. And he said, Anderson, he said, I'll tell you something. Now listen. He said, you're going to do a lot of consulting. I know damn well you are. He said, never, I mean, never take a penny from any Purdue pencil, stationery, or anything on an outside custodian. Just don't do it. That was a really good idea.
It certainly was. Chauncey Village has changed over time, hasn't it?
What?
Chauncey Village, since you've been here.
Oh, yeah. Oh, golly sakes.
Even the
I didn't even know it when we got back. You know,
a lot of that had taken place while you were gone.
Oh, yeah, from 87 on. My golly, all that train change. And, oh, we came back here 3 years ago. You know, it was a new town. Absolutely.
South River Road was north.
Oh, South River.
231? Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness sake.
Yeah, all kinds of things.
Well, I had to have Mike, our son, take us around some fairs. Avis has learned the town much better than I. I have a lot of trouble knowing where things are. But it's just amazing.
And the campus has changed a lot, too.
Oh, buildings. Boy, oh, boy.
One thing, when you came, what was housing like?
When we first came here, we got in the black and whites. They were tall, two-story buildings.
Out near Airport Road?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Right.
And these were, essentially, we rented those until we could buy. So I came here in January. But it's from Iowa, so. It was so cold, and when we were on the second floor, we had the bedrooms on the second floor, and the spaces between the boards were so big that the kids could drop cards in there down through the cracks, and they had the best time. They really loved it. And then when you go to take a shower, there was ice in the tub.
Oh, dear. Yeah. Any closing comments, anything you'd like to say or summing up? Anything special?
Yeah, I'd like to show you. You want to turn that off? I'd like to get something to show you this once.
Okay. But we'll wrap it up. Anything special you're going to, in closing? That'd be okay? You think about it?
I'd just like to say that my life at Purdue University couldn't have been any better. Absolutely. A wonderful time.
Good.
They let us have a day a week for consulting, and when I wrote the books, I always had those examples in there, and that's what made these kids really understand. And that's the reason I want to show you one.
Okay.
So that's it.
Okay, thank you.